In the late 1930s, a young filmmaker named Walt Disney occupied a unique position in popular culture. His creations were famous around the world. The characters he had originated were beloved friends of people everywhere. At the same time, Disney's constant endeavor to improve and expand his filmmaking medium had made him a darling of the cultural elite, a truly significant modern artist. From a fusion of these qualities would evolve one of the most extraordinary and influential films of the 20th century. In the short span of a decade, Walt Disney had evolved from a penniless dreamer to an international celebrity. Even decades later, however, Disney was humble about his popular and artistic ascent.
I only hope that we never lose sight of one thing, that it was all started by a mouse.
It started with Steamboat Willie, of course, in 1928 and the advent of sound.
It was sound that put Walt Disney and Mickey Mouse on the map. Walt Disney was a visionary and he was an artist, and so he made the soundtracks innovative, interesting, creative.
People responded to Mickey, and the music was kind of incidental. It was commenting on the action. Walt thought, now if we do another series of shorts, this would be in the late 20s, and we had music, and we then went off and illustrated the music, which would be the Silly Symphony concept.
This was a series in which they experimented with special effects, with color, with the way that action can be matched to music.
Walt was first and foremost a storyteller, but Walt was the storyteller as technobuff.
Three-tone Technicolor came along in 1932 and he took a chance on it. He had an exclusive contract for 2 years with Technicolor, and so his Silly Symphony series just bounded ahead in terms of quality.
He had a sense of place that meant you walked in and lived in those wonderlands, and so you needed a sense of depth. And so he got his technicians to develop the multiplane camera. And with the multiplane camera, you go into those worlds. But when you went into Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, you had a feeling of going into a story such as the best storytellers give you with their voice. But Walt gave it to you with all your senses involved, except smell, and he was always working on that.
As Walt Disney developed his craft over the years, he recognized the growing importance and power of another substantial and personal element of his medium.
I think he loved music to start with. I think he understood it as an equally powerful means of communication.
Actually, Walt was not a musician in the sense that he played an instrument. He didn't read music, but he had an instinct. He had a very definite reaction to what was right for his films. And he lived and breathed music in the sense that when he looked at a picture, he could almost hear what he wanted to hear in his brain. He was a natural musician without playing the instrument.
The late 1930s were heady times at the Walt Disney Studio. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs had just been released to overwhelming critical and public praise. The attendant financial success of Snow White afforded Disney the first real fiscal security he had enjoyed in years. He began ambitious plans for a new studio complex in Burbank, a custom-designed facility to house the eclectic and unsurpassed talents he had assembled over the previous decade.
People who were at the studio then say it was a time of tremendous creative growth and enormous stimulation because they were being asked to think harder, to perform more fully, and to stretch themselves and pushed themselves in ways they'd never even thought of before.
We had a staff there that I know that Walt felt was
the finest that could be assembled, and that he could do anything with those people, and that he had the money to do anything he wanted. And this was a rare position to be in, to have those two things.
You see, the studio was in such a formative period at that time, and there were men from literally from all over the world.
There were over 1,000 artists, and he had the finest draftsmen and the finest painters.
And animation was such a novelty. It's one thing to have live-action films, but it's another thing to have an art form of its own that's sort of owned by one guy at the time, you know.
Walt Disney held a unique position in America, and certainly in Hollywood at that time. He was considered a contemporary genius, and his studio was a mecca for visiting dignitaries and celebrities throughout that decade.
Walt Disney's films during the 1930s were like a lodestone or a magnet for all these creative people who wanted to work for him, or people that he wanted to go out and get for the studio for specific projects.
Flush with critical and commercial success, a confident and prosperous Walt Disney began what would become his most unusual, innovative, and personal film. As had happened before, Disney initiated his innovation with a steadfast mouse.
Mickey was, in 1937, world famous and world beloved. Mickey is a cheerful fella who wants to have a spectacular lot of fun without being malicious. This kind of character was not as much fun for the story department to write about than Donald Duck, who was the essence of frustration. For Donald, things never really worked out. For Mickey, things always worked out.
To help keep his story team interested in Mickey, Disney envisioned an advancement in the sophistication of Mickey's roles and acting ability.
Walt thought, why not take a piece of so-called classical music, really first-rate music, top-grade music, Dukas Sorcerer's Apprentice, and fit Mickey's actions to that.
Sorcerer's Apprentice was a lavishly created film. I mean, Walt pulled all the stops out, put the best people in the studio working on it.
A chance meeting at a Hollywood night spot brought Disney together with an unexpected and celebrated collaborator.
So the story goes, Walt Disney met Leopold Stokowski at a restaurant called Chasen's in Hollywood. And they had dinner together, and while they were talking, Walt explained that he was working on a new film.
Well, that's what started. I was doing this Sorcerer's Apprentice with Mickey Mouse, and I happened to have dinner one night with Stokowski. And Stokowski said, oh, I would love to conduct that for you, you know? Well, that led to not only doing this one little short subject, but it got us involved where I did all of Fantasia, and before I knew it, I ended up spending $400,000 getting music with Stokowski. But we were in then, it was a point of no return, we went ahead and made it.
To the American public of the 1930s, famed conductor Leopold Stokowski was the embodiment of classical music.
Stokowski became a very popular figure because he was a charismatic man. He had a very striking look to him, which in fact was caricatured in many cartoons. He was a celebrity. Even that part of the public that never listened to the classics, they knew who he was. So a collaboration between Walt Disney and Leopold Stokowski was a collaboration of two gigantically popular figures in America.
The common ground, I think, between Stokowski and Walt was that they were both really big-time showmen in their own way. Walt was very much of a self-promoter, which is not a bad thing to say about anybody, but he understood instinctively how to get publicity, how to fascinate people. He was a great storyteller, and a lot of the stories he told were about Walt, you know, so it's just the way he was. Stokowski was very much the same way with music. He was the popularizer of classical music in his day.
Stokowski and Disney assembled an elaborate orchestra session to record the score for The Sorcerer's Apprentice.
The session was done in January of 1938 at the Pathé Studios in Culver City, where a shooting stage was configured as a recording stage to accommodate a 100-piece hand-picked studio orchestra.
And they worked around the clock and then recorded
interestingly, from midnight until 3 a.m. And Stokowski said that the reason for this is that the guys were all drinking coffee, the musicians, and everybody was up and keyed, and they induced even more of a drive and a perfection.
But the expense and the effort involved in recording the orchestra, bringing in Stokowski, and going through all of this labor to make just one short subject, even to Walt, started to seem a little unwieldy.
The whole film was probably 3 times as expensive as the usual Mickey Mouse or Silly Symphony. So Walt's brother Roy, who dealt with the budgets, was very upset and said, "We're never going to make our money back on this."
But my dad really believed in what Walt was doing. He just didn't want to spend too much money doing it because there had to be a little left over to pay salaries and all that sort of thing. Stokowski, meanwhile, was all over Walt about this is a great beginning for something much larger, which is to bring classical music to the world by way of animation. And every piece of classical music in the world would lend itself to this approach, you know, and Walt, hook, line, and sinker. And of course, it was a great idea in any case.
And so he said, well, let's make a feature. Let's do a whole bunch of musical pieces, classical pieces. We'll create a concert. Yeah, that's it. We'll do a concert feature and have Stokowski conduct the whole thing.
We began to hear Walt talking about this concert feature. And we said, oh, what? What's he going to do? What's he up to now? Because you never knew what Walt was going to be thinking of next. And usually by the time we heard it, it was pretty well set in Walt's mind.
And then there were all these story conferences, and they weren't story conferences as much as selecting a repertoire that they would use for the concert. So you have not only Walt Disney and Stokowski, they brought in Deems Taylor, who was not only a composer, but he was a writer, and he was a critic, a music critic.
In addition to advising on the content of the concert feature, Taylor would assume an on-camera role as the master of ceremonies, addressing the audience and establishing a musical and artistic context.
Think of the most popular sports commentator, Howard Cosell, Bob Costas, anybody you care to name. Well, that's what Deems Taylor was, the world of classical music in the 1930s and 40s.
They had a 3-week meeting in 1938 in the fall, and they just sat around and listened to classical music, and they thought we could do this with this and this with that, and pretty soon, Walt thought, this can be a concert feature that never ends.
My room was just down the hall and over the side, so that I could hear part of the music that's going on. I'd say, they're listening to what? What are they? You know, Beethoven, Rimsky-Korsakov, and all these things. I couldn't find out what Walt was thinking about. But we knew it was something very big and very different. That was always the exciting thing about working at the studio. You never knew what was coming up next, and Walt was always miles ahead of you.
It was a wonderful thing in this sense that you had music and you had your story inside the music and you had to find it. We could, I think, let loose our imaginations because all we had for a story was musical notes, and we had to find images for those particular pieces. But there's nothing more exciting than to find music to match your idea.
For most of its development, this concert feature was titled just that, the concert feature. Both Disney and Stokowski knew that such a mundane title would never do for their flourishing masterwork.
Fantasia was one of the titles that they considered for the concert feature, and it's a musical term meaning a free form of music. And it's said that they considered dozens of other titles, but I've never been able to find out what they are. And so Fantasia was the one that stuck.
As the intoxicating collaboration of Fantasia ascended to ever loftier aspirations in music and art, the enthusiasm of Walt Disney and Stokowski permeated the entire Disney organization.
Well, Walt was expanding his own horizons terrifically at that time. Now suddenly he was into this classical music and dreaming of things that you wouldn't think of putting on the screen, you know, all these violins going together and the things which ended up in the toccata and fugue, which was just abstract music, as they called it, and the abstract symbols on the screen there. Gee, who would dare put that up for anybody to look at?
The choice of the toccata and fugue was always considered to be a piece that would be abstract, dreamlike, a good way to begin the concert feature.
Again, this was a very daring thing to do, because the only time that abstract films were done were by experimental artists, generally probably over in Germany for the most part, and here taking Bach, and which in itself was a daring thing to put on a Disney film.
The design of it was based heavily on work done by Oscar Fischinger, who was a renowned abstract animator who made his own films in Germany in the 1920s and 30s. He used geometric shapes like the circle and the triangle, but in very intricate patterns and designs. This was a type of film that was quite daring for the time in which it was made, and particularly daring for Disney, who was truly committed to representational art.
But the version that Oscar Fischinger came up with was very abstract indeed, and very Fischinger indeed. And as Walt got into Fantasia more deeply, he wanted his abstraction.
So you end up with things like lines that go up and down that then become violin bows, which is representational. Or they're put onto a horizon line, or clouds are put in the background to orient the viewer, rather than letting it just go, as Fischinger did with many things in abstractions and geometry, geometrical shapes going at the same time. So it's an interesting tension in this piece of music, this toccata and fugue section, in which a battle for the audience is going on between Walt wanting to experiment more, but being afraid to offend the audience.
Given a fear of offending the audience, it is interesting to note that Disney and Tchaikovsky chose one of the most well-known pieces of ballet music in the world, Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker Suite, and then jettisoned its familiar story.
I think the Disney people said to themselves, why should we be imitating what you can see in any high school auditorium every Christmas? And they went off in a different direction.
They wanted more of an impression of the music as seen through the different phases of nature, the seasons.
And I think what they did in this sequence, which is so important, is they demonstrated how they could personalize something abstract.
Although they did toss out the story of the Nutcracker, the traditional story that we're all familiar with, it still is a balletic production, except in this case it's not figures dancing so much, human figures, but it's leaves dancing and flowers dancing and mushrooms and that's out. So it still is a ballet, but a ballet of nature and of natural forms.
Nutcracker Suite is one of the most spectacular examples of animation that has ever been done.
Animation at the time, was the majority of it was a handmade art. There are 24 drawings per second, and each of those had to be transferred to cells, celluloid acetate. They had to be inked on the front, painted on the back, but on top of that, then they had specialists come in with airbrushes to soften the color. Then they had other people who would do dry brush. They would take a bit of color and wipe that off on a cloth and then start to put it on, so you get a sort of texture on it. Incredible stuff. For each frame of those sequences, it took an enormous amount of hand labor.
Each cell, which was only 1/24th of a second, it took them something like 3 or 4 hours to do with all those techniques.
And yet, it's the simplest sort of thing. It's what Disney artists saw when they went into a vacant lot and just looked at the plants that were growing and made drawings of them. But Walt said, the primary purpose of any of
the fine arts is to rouse a purely emotional reaction in the beholder.
And here you get an emotional reaction from kapok seeds.
Fantasia's point of origin, the Sorcerer's Apprentice, now became the concert program's memorable centerpiece.
The Sorcerer's Apprentice is the only piece of music that was adhered to as it was written. The story of the music was not altered in any way by the Disney artists. It's the same story that Duca intended in the music.
The abundant production values that Tchaikovsky had lavished on the recording of the score were matched by Disney and his artists in the creation of the visuals, not the least of which was a redesign for Mickey Mouse himself.
The design of Mickey Mouse had changed considerably from the 1920s, in which he was a very rigid design of circles. But to animate something that's a rigid circle is not that expressive. And so little by little, with different animators, particularly Fred Moore, he started to alter Mickey's design for the better. He enlarged his cranium a little bit, made him more childlike. He, most of all, gave him a pear-shaped body rather than just a rigid circle. That pear shape really worked as a malleable, animatable form. And that was very helpful when they got to do The Sorcerer's Apprentice, which is a totally pantomime role. So Mickey had to be extremely expressive in this. On top of that, they also changed his eyes.
We had talked for some time of changing those eyes because, see, originally his eyes were this big mask around here. Well, gradually that got larger and larger as you got more expressions and eyebrows and different things, lines around the eyes, until the area got so large that when his eyes went over here for a look or over here, it gave you a queasy feeling as an audience. So the animator said, can't we put pupils inside the pupils? Had a big meeting, big discussion about how are we going to do this, can we do it or not? And finally Milt Schaefer said, well, maybe if we just changed one eye at a time.
So Mickey Mouse now had expressive eyes with pupils, he had the pear-shaped body, which was extremely expressive, and with the acting of the animators, he became as wonderfully expressive as Charlie Chaplin.
You've got wonderful animators, so Les Clark, Fred Moore was the directing animator, who really understood Mickey's personality, and for the first time, you have music which is fully commensurate with what that personality is.
I think most of the animators thought of Mickey as a kind of an incarnation of Walt, although they drew the sorcerer to look like Walt when, at the end when he raises that eyebrow. That was Walt, pure and simple.
In many ways, The Rite of Spring was one of the most daring choices of music and the interpretation of it in the whole of Fantasia. It wasn't that long after The Rite of Spring had been composed and there was a riot at its opening that Disney decided to use it in his concert feature.
Stravinsky's ballet Rite of Spring was originally interpreted as a series of primitive dances. The story that Disney and Stokowski chose to tell was nothing less than the origin of life on Earth.
To tell the evolution of life on this planet was something that was a little bit more than a little daring at the time.
Now this, of course, was long before Disney's dinosaur movie and long before all of this photorealism they're able to achieve now with computer animation. But think what those artists and animators did back then. Think of what they achieved.
The multiplane camera gets a lot of attention because it's truly spectacular. But there were other things that were done in the camera department and in the special effects camera department, what was referred to as the process lab.
Very bland title, but what went on behind the doors was magic. I mean, they were just wizards back there, and they're the ones who created many of the effects that you see, the planets whirling through the sky, the mud vats that, you know, bubble up the lava, the smoke effects.
I had a good friend, I remember, who was telling me that he was out on the back lot one Sunday afternoon with five barrels of oily rags that they deliberately set on fire, and they were shooting high contrast black and white stock of the roiling black clouds that were boiling up out of this thing.
Apparently there was a vat of water, and cans of paint were turned upside down in the water. As the paint spilled out, it developed smoke patterns, and these patterns were used in development of the smoke pouring out of the volcanoes that we see during the Rite of Spring.
This was a kind of special effects that meant feeling your way back into a time before history and making it believable to audiences. It's a great benchmark for special effects.
In addition to creating a prehistoric world, Disney set his animators the challenge of creating credible prehistoric performers.
Those dinosaurs have weight and power and substance. There's nothing cartoony about them. Very little that they did up to that moment ever called on that degree of realism, that degree of dramatic power.
Walt had told the animators, he said, don't animate it like Pluto or like the dwarfs. Animate it like a real dinosaur walking, you know? And they'd say, yeah. What do you mean, if like a real dinosaur walking? Who's going to know?
When I was a kid, they used to show just the Rite of Spring sequence in school, in science class. I remember this. They'd thread up the 16-millimeter projector and show us the Rite of Spring as a kind of instructional film on the creation of the Earth. That's rather extraordinary.
For the entr'acte of Fantasia, the Disney artists dreamed up a completely unusual personality abstract, bringing character to the jagged optical line that carried the film's sound information, the soundtrack.
In many ways, the soundtrack is more abstract than what they ended up with in several sections of the Toccata and Fugue. It does start out as a single line, and it's quite marvelous to see this single line have a personality. But then it goes into these wonderful, colorful abstractions, very funny, and illustrate the feel of the music and the texture of the music just through the shapes and the way things move. Interesting thing about the Pastoral Symphony is that it wasn't the original choice for the characters that are in it. They had originally planned to use a lighter piece of music, Pierney's Cydalis.
The music wasn't big enough for what he planned, so we put it to Beethoven.
Enter the Beethoven Pastoral, which is certainly a monumental piece. And somehow the designs also went through some sort of metamorphosis. You'll see in the concept art there's a certain virility to the centaurs particularly that is missing in the later film.
We'd never done centaurs before, half human, half horse. The guys were big, robust, macho centaurs, but the girls, what do you do when you have a young girl the front end and a horse on the rear? How do you handle the anatomy, and what do you show and what don't you show? I have a whole stack of memos about how things should be drawn and long shots and close-ups and so forth. That's pretty humorous in itself.
I thought the fantasy in that was great, more so than probably any other segment. All the characters in there were fanciful characters. There's nothing in there that really exists in the real world.
As I was prejudiced through this thing, because I was, I keep trying to analyze this. Yeah, I always wanted to work on Dance of the Hours.
Dance of the Hours was a parody of the kind of highbrow dance segments that had invaded several prestige motion pictures of the time. The choice of music was part of the joke. Ponchielli's suite from the opera La Gioconda was considered, even at the time, according to a kindly worded studio communication, over-familiar.
Some people think that the Dance of the Hours section, Disney's version of it, gave the music what it deserved. It's a rather an old warhorse piece of music that needed a good kick in the pants, and it certainly got it in this one with the parody of ballet that the artist gave it.
While ballet has inspired many beautiful works of art like this painting by Degas, it had scarcely been touched upon in the field of animation. In fact, our animators knew very little about it. And because a thorough knowledge of a subject is essential in order to caricature it, a new course was added to our studio school curriculum, classical ballet.
Obviously, they worked very hard with genuine ballet performers and choreographers. But that's easier said than done. It's one thing to observe it and sketch it. It's quite another to sustain a whole sequence, an entire performance of a ballet piece, and keep it real, but make it funny at the same time.
All these artists began to respect the ballet, so they're kidding it, but underneath the kidding is a realization that this is an art form, like animation, that does it strictly through movement.
Although wildly comic and seemingly simple, this sequence features not only plausible representations of complex ballet, but also a meticulously designed production. This piece, in staging, color, and lighting, is a literal dance of hours. A pampered prima ballerina stretches toward the waking dawn. A graceful behemoth delicately glides en point in the midday sun. Lissom dancers float toward the warm evening sunset. Sinister interlopers and forbidden liaisons are diversions of the night.
And I say that is an example of a perfect piece of animation and the marriage to the background and music. It's perfect. Every once in a while you see something that's perfect. And that was one of them.
For the finale of Fantasia, Disney and Stokowski envisioned a monumental clash of good and evil. Modest Mussorgsky's baneful Night on Bald Mountain was paired with Schubert's hallowed Ave Maria.
In a sense, I think this was one of the most adult things that Disney ever did during that period.
The designs for the Night on Bald Mountain sequence were done by Kai Nielsen. Kai Nielsen was one of the three great illustrators of books at the turn of the century, and they did put him on the Night on Bald Mountain piece and the Ave Maria, so it retains the integrity of Nielsen's work. His sensuous line, the lush coloring that he had, and the combination of touch of Aubrey Beardsley, a bit of Art Nouveau, Japanese and Chinese woodcuts.
That look is so perfect in the story sketches. It's all there. All that has to be done to it is for it to be brought to life.
Walt wanted this sequence to really give you the chills. It doesn't mean literally being scared, but being drawn into an atmosphere of unease and terror and evil. And they used many skills to bring this off. Perhaps the greatest skill was the power of the great animator, Bill Tytla.
And it was just a perfect marriage of an image and the artist who could make that image move.
I think it's probably the most powerful thing we ever did. As the director, Will Jackson, said, I don't believe Walt realized he was getting a character that powerful, or he might have held back a little, because that frightened a lot of people.
When I asked Bill about Night on Bald Mountain, he said, I imagined I was a mountain, you see, and made of stone, but I could think and move, and I did.
Night on Bald Mountain and the Ave Maria, you couldn't have pieces that were more different from each other, and yet they blend rather well. So there's a real nice sort of segue in going from the profane into the sacred.
The solemn processional of the faithful was accomplished by means of one of the most elaborate single shots in film history. The scene was filmed continuously by a crew of 9 men over 6 full days and nights, using a horizontal multiplane camera set up across the entire 154-foot length of the Disney Studio soundstage. Disney and his team felt that the complexity of filming the scene was warranted by its ethereal design.
We again have the designs of Kai Nielsen. The procession going through the forest leads up to an actual sort of cathedral of trees, and then in close to a giant stained glass window, and then even in closer and you come up to the design of a Madonna. Well, as you might guess, this was a much more religious ending than what finally ended up in the film.
Well, the world is waiting for a sunrise. End on a sunrise. There's the essence of hope. And they ended with the perfect image of hope, sun coming up.
In addition to their innovative work blending animation, art, and music, during the production of Fantasia, Disney and Stokowski originated a pioneering form of motion picture presentation. Disney had already established a benchmark in visual presentation.
Well, to enhance that, they decided, and again, Stokowski was very much involved with this, that the sound had to be better than it would be for an ordinary feature film.
The plan was that rather than doing the tracks, the music tracks in Hollywood, that they would go back to the Philadelphia Academy of Music, where Leopold had his Philadelphia Orchestra, And the sound, the acoustics, and the whole ambiance, sound-wise, was perfect.
And so the engineering team at Disney and a whiz named Bill Garrity got to work with his people and with Stokowski and with others to create what we would think of now as stereophonic sound. They gave it the name Fantasound, but I think even privately they hadn't yet envisioned that name, stereophonic, to indicate sound that surrounds you, sound that has many different speakers and channels.
50 years ago, I would have walked in there knowing what I know today, and I wouldn't have believed what they were doing. They sat around and said, you know, we've got to do something about a mono sound. It doesn't sound right. Let's come up with stereo. Let's design it left, center, right. Then they said, let's put a surround track and it'll give you an acoustical feeling of a concert hall. That's today's philosophy. We are doing nothing different. These people started from scratch, and what they did is unbelievable.
So not only did you have the Philadelphia Orchestra, which had a glorious sound to it, conducted by the most famous conductor in the country at the time, but you had it presented in a form of sound that had never been heard in a movie theater before. Never. I think Walt saw Fantasia as something other than an animated feature film. He really envisioned something that would be a hybrid of a film presentation and a concert. Something brand new that didn't exist before. It was presented as what they used to call a roadshow attraction. And that meant you had to purchase tickets as you would for a concert or a play.
You had two shows a day, and people bought their tickets in advance, and they had a reserved seat, and it was an event.
Given Disney's ambitious exhibition plans for Fantasia, it's not really surprising that his film distributor, RKO Radio Pictures, balked at the enormous effort and expense of this roadshow.
RKO did not want to handle Fantasia. They didn't have any faith in it. So the decision was made that we do everything ourselves.
Now Disney was not only a filmmaker, but a theatrical impresario. He hired his own team to plan and supervise every aspect of the Fantasia Roadshow experience, from curtain and lighting cues to the theater marquee and usher corps.
The theater staff was trained properly to take each patron to their seat. We also had programs, a beautiful program, and we put that to use. That was also part of the show. It was not just sitting down, but they had something in front of them and something that they kept and something that they cherished.
This was an event. This is the kind of event you might even get dressed up to go to. And you paid a higher ticket price than you would for a regular showing of a movie at your neighborhood theater.
So it was not just a film that they were going to. It was an experience.
Of course, Walt's timing couldn't have been worse.
The roadshow release of Fantasia was not a success for a variety of reasons.
I think the critics were baffled. They didn't know whether to put, the newspapers didn't know whether to send their musical critics to cover it or their movie critics.
There are some just ecstatic reviews of it that are just over the top, unbelievable. But there were others who were the music critics, basically, pardon me, music critics, who were purists about the music.
Well, actually, it was not highbrow. It was not lowbrow. It was Disney. It was for everyone.
Those people who knew what they were in for were very, very receptive and couldn't stop talking about it.
New York, they ran for over a year, packed houses, day in, day out, day in, day out. People going back to it time and time again. In Los Angeles, it ran for a year. San Francisco ran for 45 weeks, 47 weeks, something like that, nearly a year. Now that's a very good record for a roadshow of a picture, particularly in those days. So it was well received in the big, larger areas.
But I think the general public reacted to it favorably, those who saw it, but there was such a limited group who saw it, really, when you figure the amount of theaters it played in.
There were no more than 12 venues that were ever equipped to show Fantasound, and records show that there were never more than 16 prints manufactured.
Fantasia's release was so scattered and inconsistent because of the problems of the installation, because of the problems of only having two shows a day, that it was almost destined not to make money.
The cost of fitting this into a theater ran to about $85,000. This is pre-World War II dollars, a tremendous amount of money.
What's more, World War II was already underway in Europe, and there was the threat that they would not be able to release the film overseas.
Dejected, Disney returned the distribution of Fantasia to RKO Radio Pictures.
By January of 1941, RKO had been persuaded to continue the road shows under their banner, which did happen beginning in April of 1941. But the apathy of the box office, the apathy of the public, made RKO realize they weren't going to hit a home run with this. And they determined, with Disney's approval, to cut the 124-minute Fantasia down to an 81-minute popular version, which played out nationwide in 1942. All of the interstitials with Mr. Taylor were cut. The Toccata and Fugue was dropped from the program entirely, making a very tight and perplexing 81 minutes of music, which the Heartland just didn't take to its heart.
Yeah, one of the things that Walt wanted to do was to make Fantasia a perpetual entertainment, in that you could change the program, like you could a concert.
They would do another number, and perhaps after it had been out for a year and a half, add a number and maybe subtract a number, and then in a few more months add another number.
And we can release it again, or we can keep it in continual release, and you will every year go to see Fantasia, and it will always be new. And Walt was developing a lot of new segments. Clair de Lune, Swan of Twinella. Ride of the Valkyries. Art was being produced.
Stokowski recorded the first four numbers for that, and they were well on their way, but then they just couldn't make it with the short finances and the war and the problems of all that, it died.
The failure of Fantasia was a thorn in Walt's side for the rest of his life.
Following Pinocchio and coming into the Fantasia period.
Yeah, that about did it, you know.
But that was a new
artistic success, financial failure. You know?
Certainly an artistic success. It was a magnificent.
Well, some people would question that too.
He'd put so much into this movie emotionally, not to mention financially, that he never really got over that. He also knew that it was a sound idea, no pun intended. He knew that it was a good, solid idea, that putting images to music was appealing and was a stimulus for his artists. And he kept doing it.
He tried to do other types of Fantasia. There were the package films in the 1940s, Make Mine Music and Melody Time. Some of it involved some classical music and mostly popular music. He also did things later in the 1950s. There was The Grand Canyon, which was interesting because it was directed by James Algar, who had directed The Sorcerer's Apprentice, so there's a real matching picture to music in that as well.
Time went by, and it kept coming back, and there would be an audience for it, and then it would be reissued perhaps in another 5 or 7 years. And suddenly it became more and more popular in its reissues, and more people were warming to it over the decades. And we're talking about many decades. And as time went by, it became kind of a classic. And indeed, it was a classic, it is a classic.
time heals a lot of wounds and a lot of opinions.
It's become a cult picture now, and it plays somewhere every day all over the world.
Fantasia has been a milestone, I think, for the company right from the beginning, because first of all, they did a lot of stuff when they made it that they didn't even know themselves that they could do.
The sheer beauty of this picture, it was so different than anything that had been done before.
I mean, this was a work of art, and it still is, for that matter. I mean, it's the first time anything really that significant had been done in film.
I think that if Fantasia had proven to be a hit at the box office with the general public, there's no telling who he would have gone after in terms of writers and poets, dancers, painters, to bring them in to this wonderful process of animation.
And of course, the big thing personally that I feel was a little tear in my heart is, where would we be today if that picture had been as successful as Walt had hoped it would be?
Mm-hmm.